You've been lied to, but you don't know how. You've searched, you've struggled, you've cried out. You want the truth, but where is it? You've wandered, you've fought, you've strived, and you have not been satisfied. What is truth? Where is truth? Who is truth? The kingdom of God, mind control, the last days, higher dimensions, unity, the power of faith, discovering the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. God has promised that He will hide us under His feathers, and under His wings we will trust. His truth shall be our shield and our buckler. Discovering the Truth with Dan DeVaughn is the premier program that is designed to center you on the kingdom of God, to equip you with faith in Jesus Christ, and to unveil the truth behind the lies. This program is designed to show you how to become more than you have ever imagined through the power of truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And now, prepare for your host, Dan DeVaughn.
We are now sitting down with Dr. C.R. Oliver. And folks, it's been nearly a year since I've had Dr. Oliver on the program. And you know what? I am so excited to have him back today. He is a retired college professor, ordained minister. He's also the president of the Oliver Evangelistic Association International and the CEO of Zadok Publications. He's the author of a number of books, including one I recommend highly called The Sons of Zadok, also Solomon's Secret, and quite a few other books. I just want to thank you so much for taking the time out of your schedule, Dr. Oliver, to join us on Discovering the Truth with Dan DeVaughn.
Oh, Dan DeVaughn, you know, you're a favorite of mine. How can anybody miss that smile and be blessed by you so much for your prayers, the work that you've done and continue to do overseas and here? Tremendous place in the kingdom, and I thank God for knowing you. You know, today is an unusual day. I just finished working the newsletter for the January 1st newsletter. I put out a newsletter every month, and people can go there if they want to and sign up to Zadok Publications. But we're not advertising. Matter of factly, the sole distribution of all our books comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. My wife this morning told me we just got an email that 12 books are sold online today. Mm. So praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
It goes out over worldwide, and we're grateful for it. And I have a word for 2016.
I really can't wait to let you talk to us about it, Dr. Oliver. And so, you know what, folks? His website is www.zadok. That's Z-A-D-O-K publications.com. Be sure you check it out. And his writings are amazing. And I don't just say that because I like him. So check that out as well. But Dr. Oliver, I mean, you really do have something spectacular to share. So I'm going to sit back and be quiet and take notes like everyone else and just listen.
May it be a time of note giving for sure. It's a very serious, almost serious, too serious a broadcast, because it is so important. The Lord emphasized on me about 3 weeks ago, I want you to write on 2 Timothy 2:19. It's the word I'm giving you for those that are under your mantle, of course, for 2016. It's the first time I've ever given a word for a new year, so it's not something that's ordinary. And I put the finishing touches on it just this morning, a few moments actually before this broadcast. And what I've written is covered over 15 pages, which we are not going to read all of it today, but we are going to touch on some of the major themes that are there. You know, the passage that he gave me is a familiar passage in pulpits and so forth, but it has never hit me quite like it has under his direction. Mm-hmm. I'm going to just read the passage. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal. The Lord knows those that are his, and let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. A little passage is succinct, because the focal scripture is the word for 2016. Positioned in the flow of Paul's writing to Timothy, it stands like a rock in a raging sea of unbelief and deceit and sin. Because Timothy's days were like our own, full of trouble within the church and outside of the church. And Paul understood the overwhelming duties of the pastorate that he was talking about in Timothy's life. And realizing that he might have kind of overloaded the young man with the first six chapters of 1 Timothy and the first chapter of 2 Timothy, he came back with a powerful statement. He said, nevertheless, don't worry about it. If you see rottenness in the pulpit, rottenness in the pew, if you discover trouble outside that's overwhelming you, remember this, nevertheless, the foundation of the Lord is sure. He can count on it. It's like the house builded upon the rock. It's something you can go back and touch base with. It's something you base your ministry on. That sure foundation is having this seal. It's three parts, as you can see in that verse. First part, the sure foundation of the Lord. The second part, the Lord already knows. Since the beginning of time, he has known those that are his. And therefore, it's the judgments and the things that happen because of people are not necessarily your problem. God's going to take care of that issue. Third area is an area that all of us need to really examine in our lives. And that's simply this. Let everyone who names the name of Jesus depart from iniquity. Now, he goes on to talk about what iniquity is later on, but I want to tell you this. It's like saying, Timothy, lash yourself to this verse. When the storm breaks, when the latter days get here, when the issues of life begin to overwhelm the church, and they are going to have to rise up and say, our foundation is sure in the Lord, and we stand against all principalities and powers, and we separate ourselves from anything that looks like sin. Now, you and I have understood that many people talk about little sins and big sins. Sin is sin. But their construct of iniquity is different. They think that's murder or apostasy or something like that, but it's deeper than that. It can be the motive by which you minister. It could be the association of pastors needs to recognize that sometimes when filthy lucre comes in the spotlight, and the word of God is in contradiction to it, that they choose the filthy lucre, and that's iniquity. It is a truth that is so profound, though, this verse, is that it becomes like a center pole of a huge tent and covers all of 1 and 2 Timothy. It says, engulfed in the scope of all of that you are going to be and have been already exposed to in my writing. I want you to know that standing above it all is nevertheless the foundation of the Lord is sure. That in 2016, when the things start shaking and the issues get larger than they are now, and there are plenty of them, my readers all know and understand what's facing the church and what's facing the world. I mean, you have the media in front of them, have all sorts of people telling you what issues are, all the way from terrorism and ISIS and all of that, all the way down to apostasy in the church. We know the situation, but what do you do when it comes? You stand on the solid foundation. all other things seem to move out from that, and that nevertheless supersedes whatever dilemma can be placed on it. You see, we might say, someone said, well, you look here, Lord, I have this huge problem, and it's eating at me with such tenaciousness that it occupies my mind and my total horizon. I need your help, Lord. Where shall I go? And the answer comes back, nevertheless, the foundations I have laid are sure, and I know those that are mine. You're mine. And now if you've got sin in your life, depart from it, and let Jesus be glorified in your life. What an easy thing that is, but deep inside intones the Spirit of God, emphasize that nevertheless. This verse covers empires. This verse covers storms. This voice of God nevertheless is a gigantic presence with arms outstretched to comfort just when it's needed, because it's an anchor to the soul. You know, Dan, the power of this verse begins to move in you as you repeat it. And I think it bears repeating every day. I think it needs to be looked at every day. You wake up in the morning, nevertheless, the foundation of the Lord is sure. Needs to be the last thing you think of at night, nevertheless, it is sure. But name what you will, political intrigue, Islamic terrorism, moral decline, spiritual malaise, whatever you want to say, the halls of heaven have one invective. Nevertheless, the foundation of the Lord is sure. His plan will go forth. I remember when Elisha, little servant boy, came running over to him and said, wake up, wake up. They got a big problem outside. And he said, what is it? And he carried him to the window and he said, look at that. It looks like armies above armies. And he asked the Lord, Lord, don't let this young man see as the circumstances of the world, as the world looks at natural events. Let this boy have his eyes open. Let this young man see as he's not seen before. Let him see what I see. And immediately, in that moment, he stood and looked out over that window one more time. And standing above every one of those soldiers was a soldier of angels, with swords drawn, ready to bring them down. And 180,000 did. 180,000 at one whack. And we're worried about ISIS. And we're worried about the events of time. Lord, let us have our eyes open. May we see that nevertheless the foundations of the Lord are sure. I can guarantee you one thing, Dan. That servant boy never looked at the circumstances of life again in the same way.
You know, C.R. Oliver, I was going to just be quiet the whole time and just let you preach.
Shout on, brother.
See, you're getting me fired up. It's what you're doing. And this is what I notice. Everyone wants a concrete slab. They want a concrete slab, something that they can touch and feel in the natural, to say the foundations are now sure, because I can see this. And what we forget is that the foundations of the Lord, really, the rock of our foundation, Jesus Christ, well, that's a spiritual conversation. The foundation doesn't have to be a concrete slab that you can touch for it to be sure. But your confidence has to be in the God who is spirit.
Oh, amen.
Oh,
when you think about it, that's what, when Paul wrote Ephesians 2:19, now therefore you're no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. You know, you think about that foundation, and you recognize that Paul was a late apostle, but he recognized his position in the foundation of God, and we must also. See, we can stand on God's foundation and be assured of stability. The rest of the world may be rocking, but that's not rocking. He is not only the rock of our defense, but if we say God said it and that settles it, then come to 2 Timothy 2:19 and say, if God said it, that settles it. Only on this foundation must the church abide. You see, I know theology is great. I've been to a seminary. I know that doctrine's wonderful. I've pastored in churches, in denominational churches, and had a doctrinal line. I also know what it is if you find a scripture that doesn't apply to it or doesn't work with it, how quickly a group of elders will inform you that you are outside the boundaries of that doctrinal position. But neither will fare very well in the coming adversarial situation in 2016. This is a tremendous year ahead of us, and standing on those promises is necessary. It is a singular foundation in which we must abide. For deep in the soil of the prophets and the apostles, God has laid a sureness. Jesus is the chief cornerstone. And in the old days when masons, I've done a little bricklaying in my day, and when a mason, we put in a cornerstone now after the building's built. Funny. But in the old days, that cornerstone made everything true, everything level, everything correct that came after it. And we must be true, and we must be on the level with God, and we must walk in such a way as that we will be a permanent part of that holy temple. Look now, if you will, I'll get off the foundation and go to the seal. You know, we're sealed in the Spirit. I wrote a book entitled Sealed Unto His Coming. 600 pages. It's far too long. But, you know, it looks at all the passages, or most all passages in the Word of God, Old and New Testament, that were sealed. In other words, it didn't matter what happened in history or who was elected president or what. It was going to be done, and praying about it wouldn't do any difference. In other words, it's not a matter of getting out. If we repent and we turn, that'll be changed. No, the things we're talking about are immovable, and they are insurmountable as well. And when he says in this verse that the seal is that God already knows from the foundation of the world those that are his, the book can be sealed. The names are already written. Your name and my name is already there. And if it isn't, it's time to get it there. It's time to move in the Spirit in a way that we've not moved before. Well, if he knows those that are his, then I want to know those that he knows are his.
Amen.
I don't want to know anybody else. I want to know the book of Jude when it says in the last days there will be spoken of evil of God's dignitaries. That tells me there's some dignitaries on the earth. Lord, I want to know who they are. I don't want you to introduce me to the right reverend somebody and say he's a big dog in our denomination. He's a dignitary. No, that's not right. What may be right is this. Give me the little person that's pushing the broom in the background and prays 3 or 4 hours in tongues every day and called on the Lord to bring about power in the church. That's a dignitary. That's the ones I want to meet. I want to be able to say to them, I love you, brother, because you're in the kingdom. I love you, sister, because you do the right things before God. I was standing outside a funeral of a missionary friend of mine last year. Brother Courier, a great man of God, and spoke Spanish fluently, and he died from Agent Orange, from being in Vietnam. But Brother Courier had a funeral. It was filled with people who were influenced by his life. He was only 60-something years old. There was a man standing holding the door of everybody going out. He just unpretentious. When I walked past him, the Holy Ghost said, dignitary. And I thought, Lord, I've got to know this guy. So I didn't make any moves at that point. I thought, the Lord will bring me around here again. Because you see, the sureness of God doesn't waver. The opportunity won't be lost. Got in my car, my wife and I, and we started to go almost off the ramp before I remembered that was what God said. Got back in my car and drove up under the portico where he was standing with his wife. And he said, "Welcome, brother," and began to speak in tongues and prophesy some things unbelievable into my life. And I jumped out of that car and grabbed him with a hug. I'd never seen him before that funeral. And we have been bosom buddies ever since. That's the kind of person I want to know. I don't want to know your big shots. I don't want to know your mega church men. They all may be fine and good. But you see, I can't get through all of their band of people around them that surround them. I can't get to talk to them because they're not available. But the little people of God, those dignitaries that stand out in heaven and of whom hell is trembling and afraid, that's the ones I want to know. Oh, you're one of them, brother. Can I tell you that? Because you know, our meet was not by happenstance, and neither is this broadcast.
You know, Dr. Oliver, the reason why you know dignitaries and the Lord reveals them to you is because you are as well. And you've been for a very long time holding a very special place in the Lord's heart. And the reason why when you begin to speak, the weight of God's presence hangs on your words is because you share language with him.
Oh, Lord.
And that's why the first time I spoke with you, I was profoundly floored, because I've met a lot of people and talked to quite a few leaders at this point, and my spirit just discerns things. And, you know, I discerned immediately with you. I was like, wow, I just really want to sit and listen to you talk.
Well, bless you. I sometimes find myself weeping in front of the computer because I write. You know, I'd rather write than talk, really, because in writing you have a delete button and you can go back and erase it. Well, some things you can do on this broadcast like that if you trim them up, but I'm not talking about that generally. If you're speaking in front of congregations and all, there has to be the flow of heaven. People haven't seen what it is to see the high priest in their pulpits, standing before God in the entirety of the pureness and consciousness of their heart, before the Lord, honored by him and him them honoring God, as they look on his back while he ministers in the very throne room of God and takes the message off of the fire of coals that stand before the Lord and put them on his lips and move in the Spirit in such a way as he gives answer before eternity while he's speaking. That's the way Paul was. That's what we must see return to the pulpit. Either that or we must change ourselves and not call ourselves Christians, born-again believers anymore. Because to stand before the Lord is to stand in purity and holiness and righteousness and truth, and these things are not emphasized enough. Well, you get me off my pattern here, but it's all right. That's part of it, isn't it, Brother Duvall? The Holy Ghost grabs hold of you sometime, and just go ahead and say it.
Sometimes it has to be said. You know.
You know. Go ahead.
No, I want to know what you know, brother.
Well, I was just looking at the third part of that verse. I mean, it's hard for me to see that verse without three parts. Sure foundation, the Lord knows who those are his. And the third part, depart from iniquity. And I began to think, well, that's all sin, you know, known sin and unknown sin and all the kind of sins we deal with. And I thought about this. We know where those Ashtaroths and darling sins are. In the Old Testament, that's what he said. You know, get away from the idols of Ashtaroth and the darling sins. Forsake them. Well, in the New Testament, the people are urged to repent. Get back to something more than just a communal morality. stand before the Lord in your own righteousness, because he's given you that righteousness to stand in. What it means, though, for me, is a simple word for 2016. If you're sinning, stop doing it, get your right heart right with God, or it'll be too late soon. I believe the foundation of this verse is so powerful that if it's introduced in the pulpits of America, it'll make a change toward revival in the hearts of the people. But you can't do it with a heart that's not right before God. You see, I see this great passage floating in the middle of the greatest treatises that Paul ever wrote concerning the condition of the church. When he used the word adikia, it was a word, a legal word, that meant living in injustice. It meant the quality by which your life is and the implications of what you do, the acts that you do. What do they speak louder than your words? It's a morality based on righteousness. Wrongfulness of character and life and act is iniquity. And when the King James uses it, it means unrighteousness, to live wrong, to live outside the power of his will. And when I read that, I think Paul lays down this principle governing aspects for calling oneself a Christian. So somehow we've lost sight of what it is to be real and what isn't. Through some mystic fog, the church is vaguely able to see what really counts. But this verse tells what really counts. It counts that you're on the foundation of God, that you know who you are in Him, and that you've departed from iniquity. Now, Paul went on to say what he thought about the spirit of iniquity. I'm not talking about the mystery of iniquity now. I'm talking about the spirit of iniquity. The mystery of iniquity is in the world. Shouldn't be in the church. But if you talk about dens of iniquity, you don't think about it, including the church in that program. You know, you think about, well, the house of prostitution, or someplace they're dealing in cocaine, or some gross sin out in the world. No, no, no. It could be your associates. It could be the business that you're in. It could be the friends that you have. It could be the situation you find yourself in at home. Iniquity abounds. But grace does more abound. We know that. We're not a hyper-grace people, but we are people who know that Paul had the grace of God upon him. He was a blasphemer. He was a murderer. He was all of those things that a person shouldn't be, but he did it, as he said, ignorantly. And the grace of God intervened for him, and he found out this foundation that he's talking about. And he walked into the presence of God. For 3 years he learned from God on the backside of nowhere. And he learned that you can't be in the ministry without suffering, and you can't be in the ministry without having to pay a price for telling the truth. A lot of people are trying. Today, not one pulpit rails about anything. And the lawless have found their way into the channels of religion, and we now have it said very equally. We have mild-mannered men teaching mild-mannered other mild-mannered men how to be mild-mannered. They write books that do not say anything. Their theologies are half an inch deep. There's nothing that calls and challenges the inner man to change or make any moves. But unless every message carries with it a call, and that call is more than just to come and join the church, it's a call to come and bow before these verses that we're talking about and say, of all heaven and earth, this is what counts in my life. I want to read a few verses, not all of them related, but 1 Timothy 1:9-10. When you begin to look at that verse, the lawless, the insubordinate, the ungodly, he said the law of God was for them, for sinners, for the unholy, the profane, the murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for fornicators, for sodomites, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjurers. And if there's any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, it's for them. We who are in Christ Jesus have been redeemed from the law and removed from the curse. But we look like that verse. That verse applies to us. And much of what is in the church today applies to that verse, sadly. He said the church has turned to idle talk. The people who lead it have desired to be teachers of the law, but they understand neither what they say nor the things which they affirm. I mean, that's 1 Timothy 6 and 7. This is what he's saying to Timothy in the early church. He's saying, this goes on in your church. He goes on in 1 Timothy and he says, having rejected concerning the faith, they have suffered shipwreck. Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme. How many shipwrecks have we got in the congregations today? How many of those people? He knew what a shipwreck was, you know. He floated in the sea for a long time before he finally did make it to land, and then got bitten by a snake. Threw the snake off, and the venom that was in the snake said, uh-oh, I've gotten the wrong blood count, DNA here. Died and fell off. That's the kind of Christians we want to raise up in 2016. Those that can identify with that. Not shipwrecked without hope. It says, in the latter days, they will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits, doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. Now, I want to tell you, for those that are in that category, there's not but one thing the pastor can do, and that is run. He can throw the grenade in the camp, but he better be running away from him, because that group is malicious and they will die for their hypocritical stand. They will die for their deceit. They'll do whatever it is to be incorrigible to you. But we have not cast off our first faith, brother. We stand in the midst of it. But many have not. That's what iniquity is. He's not, as we used to say, pussyfooting around. he's not making light of the situation. He's not saying, well, just talk about this if you want to, and if it doesn't seem to be palatable to your congregation, wait till it is. No. I remember being in Curitiba in South Paraná, Brazil. I remember as if it were yesterday. 1,200 people in that church, the First Baptist Church. I'm in that pulpit. A mighty university is there. One of the great Baptist theological seminaries is there. And yet a woman and her husband in Oklahoma had called me prior to going there and said, the key to going to that church is Jeremiah 5. If you preach on that, it'll unlock the door. I didn't hardly believe it, but the prophecy was there. When it got down to Wednesday night and I began to preach on Jeremiah 5, the Holy Ghost took that message, and within five verses, a man stood up and began to cry out, forgive me my sins. And he fell like he was dead in between the pews. Another one began to run to another in that congregation, and another to another. And they were weeping on each other's shoulders, and they were saying, I've sinned against you and against heaven. I've said things about you that were not true, and I want to be forgiven. For four solid hours, I never got through the fifth chapter of Jeremiah. Who can get through what the Holy Ghost is doing? Because he can take the Word of God and move it into the hearts of people and reach to that darling sin, that place of iniquity, and strike it. And if there's a response, they will come running before the Lord. That's what we want today. The invitation is still there. And it's not only the church in Curitiba, but you see, when that congregation was over, as I went out the door, the pastor hugged me and he said, listen, brother, you've touched on every sin that was in this congregation. I knew it, but I was fearful to preach it. I was fearful to stand. I was fearing that my family would be cast out and my money supply would be gone. But you have done what I couldn't do, and the Holy Ghost has done more than I could expect. Little would he know on that Wednesday night that Friday the theological seminary would call me on the carpet and say, "You will never preach in Brazil again in one of our churches because you have ruined this church, you have messed it up, you have caused a great confusion and dilemma within the people." Now, Dan, that's the truth, so help me God.
I have no problem believing that is exactly what happened to you.
When we move in the Spirit of God, things are going to happen around us that we aren't prepared for and we don't even want to be. We just want to be there when it happens. Oh, that it would happen in every church. Oh, that we'd have an opportunity to walk in the pulpits of 1,000 places and preach. And then, see the move of the Spirit. Oh, I've been there. I've been there. Depart from Iniquity is not a mega church nightmare. Where the pastors shudder at the loss of every giver. Depart from Iniquity must be the preachment of the day. It must be the order of the hour. So what if the crowd thins and the Holy Ghost grins? That'd be a good standoff, a good reasonable settlement. Many of those who would depart could no longer be your associate or be welcome at your family reunion. I've had whole congregations, half of them, get up and walk out in my sermons. It was too hard for them. Just because I told them the Lord gave them the keys to the kingdom, but he didn't hear any locks opening, any chains rattling, and any people shouting that they were free and released. And it was time to minister in the Spirit or quit talking about being a charismatic body. You see, some messages are too tough for today's crowd. But repent now and change now is what John Wesley preached on his father's grave, because they wouldn't allow him in the churches. The only piece of real estate he owned was his daddy's grave. So he stood on the mausoleum over his daddy's grave and preached to a crowd that broke loose to what is called now the Methodist Church. My, that was a good trade-off. You see, if we began to preach this message, the altars would be full. If the call was poignantly specific to depart from Iniquity, the healing line might be shorter, but the gospel train would be fuller. God, help us see some preachers preach something greater than hyper grace. Help us to stand on the immovable foundation and challenge the church with 1 Timothy 1 and 1 Timothy 2 and 1 Timothy 3 and 5 and 6 and the first chapter of chapter 2, verse 1. The altars would be filled with repentant people, something that hadn't been done in decades. And some has never been done in some congregations. Well, Paul said, "Timothy, I know that you're about to get overwhelmed with all the things I'm going to be talking about. Just what I've mentioned alone would be something. So I don't want you to be overwhelmed. I want you to hear that nevertheless, the foundation of the Lord is sure. Because I want you to anchor the same way I anchored my life. I want to give you a testimony of that. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who enabled me because he counted me worthy and faithful. And he put me into the ministry just like he put you in the ministry through prophecy. Although I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and an insolent man, I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ. I was anointed a preacher, an apostle. And I just want to write this as 1 Timothy 3. that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, which is the pillar and ground of the truth, and without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness, and it's housed in God's people, in that church builded on that foundation. Therefore, don't be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor be ashamed of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the suffering for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling. Oh, my Lord. Not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which is given to us in Christ Jesus before time began, but now has been revealed by the appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, to which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, a teacher of the Gentiles. For this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I believe, and I'm persuaded he's able to keep that which I've committed to him until that day. My, what credentials. Oh, we've got seminary graduates and theology men and doctors hanging off the walls. I know. But they mean nothing. They're counted as dung. They're like the genealogy of the Benjamites. He said to young Timothy, remember that Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead, according to my gospel, for which I suffered trouble as an evildoer, even in the point of change, but the word of God is not changed. My, if he just stopped at that point, if the word of God is not changed, you know, I've been believing, Dan, for building a church in North Korea. One of the brethren in Cambodia, we built four churches in Cambodia and some in other places of the world we can't even mention. But he said to me, it's not possible to build one in North Korea. But I remember in 1975, I was standing on the Yalu River at Panmunjom, looking across from the South Vietnam, South Korea side to North Korea shore, and I saw a huge, beautiful white bird, sort of like our egrets, but huge beyond that. That bird took off in the air from the south side and crossed the river and landed with majestic beauty and folded his wings on North Korea. You know, that boundary didn't mean a thing to him. That 38th parallel was absolutely not even in his existence. And the Lord struck me and said, my word is that way. My spirit is that way. We know no boundaries. We know no demarcations. We know no lines of separation. And looking at that bird at that point in time, I said, Lord, we're going to build a church in North Korea. I don't care what it looks like now. I don't care what the circumstances look like in the future. But we will stand on the foundation of God, and the church will be born and birthed in the open out there in North Korea. I'm still believing for it. I'm going to see it come to pass. He said in 2 Timothy 3:10, but you, Timothy, have carefully followed my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long suffering, my love, my perseverance, my persecution, my afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch and Iconia and at Lystra, where he was beaten, what persecutions I endured. And out of them all, the Lord delivered me. Yes. And all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. But just remember, the Lord will deliver you. What words do we speak to young pastors today? What are our seminaries teaching? What are the seminars in foreign fields that are conducted by so many denominations? Right now, the local pastors of foreign churches have a hard time keeping up attendance to the seminars that are brought. One group brings a 1 week or a 10-day seminar. They bring all the food and money from the U.S. Another group comes from Canada, teaching another doctrine altogether, but they're there. Another group comes from Great Britain, from Australia, bringing pastoral training. I hear about it all the time. Many ministers report and I hear them. But the opportunity is this: what are we teaching those men? Are we teaching him what Paul said to Timothy? Are we teaching something about our doctrine, or our way of life, or the way we conduct our ministry, or how our churches ought to look? Are we transporting our culture and not transporting our Jesus? For I am poured out, he said, like a drink offering. And the time of my departure is very near. That's why I'm telling you these things, Timothy. I'm not going to be here very long. And I'm telling you the important things you need to know in your ministry. For I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. And there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. And the righteous judge will give to me in that day, and not me only, but to all those who love his appearing. But what about that pastor? So you see that the Lord was so close to Paul at that time that in this book of Timothy, he gave one of the greatest diadems that I have ever read. Here's what he said in 1 Timothy 1:17. Now the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. He closed that book with these words: He who is blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in an unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. Oh, that be put to song. Oh, that be the opening foray to the worship service. Oh, that the reading of that would come across from the denomination out of a pure heart, that the congregation would bow down before God at the very beginning. It would be better than the rock and roll, atomized experiences that we're seeing on platforms today as the entertainment group tries to get the Dove Award or move in some sphere beyond the church. We need to come back and recognize that only out of a pure heart can come pure praise. No substitute will do. Well, let's find out what he told Timothy. I've separated those scriptures. And I think when somebody gets my newsletter, they'll see how easy it is to separate them. Not twist them. Not make it do something the Bible doesn't say. But the charge of Paul to Timothy is not given to idle words. These are what every preacher of the gospel must know and abide by. And he says, in essence, look at my example. Follow me. These are not recommendations and suggestions to be reviewed and then cast aside at your own discretion. In order to be God's man, you must know these things. Wow. What would be the last things I would write to my son in the ministry? I have a man that was on the phone just as we got into our discussion. He's wanting to come and take some of my anointing. He says, I've just got to be in your presence, brother. Well, there's a lot of people who want to do that. But this man has a special anointing on his life. So what would I share with him? What do dying men say to other dying men? What is the portent of the gospel? Well, it starts in 1 Timothy 1:18. This charge I commit to you, son Timothy. You couldn't get any closer than that. According to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by those prophecies you may wage the good warfare. I say to you, Brother Duval, the prophecies we're hearing in churches today are not prophetic. They're pathetic. They're not the kind that Paul was talking about to Timothy. Because he moved. You remember when Paul was making that journey back to Rome? They told him, you're going to die there, you're going to die there. They prophesied, you better quit, you're going to die there. He says, I've heard all the prophecy I want. I know that what you're telling me is true because you've got a word from God. But in spite of all that, nevertheless, the foundation of the Lord is sure, and I'm going to go there and do my thing because God wants me to. Now, we haven't heard many prophetic words that you could go out and fight a good battle with. We've heard little things like, well, the Lord, thus saith the Lord, This year, your life will change. This year, you're going places spiritually you've never gone before. And those little prophetic words are fine for the pathetic congregation that they're going in. But I say it's time to hear from God. When men of God stand and women of God stand and pour out from an altar of coals of fire upon the hearts of people so that they know what is read is from God's own throne. I had that happen to me last week. I was in the presence of two prophetic people. I dearly loved them with all my heart. I was visiting them. My wife's birthday, they wanted me here to come down and visit with them. The Lord broke loose and gave prophetic word on Thursday night that shook me to the ground and gave me something to live by for the rest of this coming year. Hallelujah. That's the kind of prophecies you abide by. You can count on them. I've seen those two people prophesy first in tongues and then interpretation of tongues and give prophetic words that came to pass. Before my eyes, I know they're true before the Lord. What do we do? What do we say about our people today? Here's my command to you, he said. Fight well in the Lord's battles. Well, just what are the Lord's battles? A lot of the things we're fighting are our battles.
You know, if I can just say this, you are 100% correct on that. One of the things that God has just really, really driven home for me personally is that his assignments align us with his agendas. And when we are walking in his agendas, that's when we have access to his protection and his provision and his authority in that sphere of influence to take the territory that's been appointed as part of his kingdom assignment and blueprint and agenda. It all works together. When there are battles, it's our resources and our protection and so on and so forth. Wow.
Wow, indeed. 2016, we're going to need God's protection because we're going to be doing God's battles. But at the same time, we need more than what we got in the way of preparation. I remember a brother up in the WOW Center in Virginia, dear friend of mine. This brother leads a group of 800 young people. And he took a good, modest, goodly number down to one of the Spanish-speaking countries. And he realized that his preaching was not being thoroughly translated by the translator. And he said, Lord, I need a miracle. He's a young man about 30 years of age. I need a miracle, Lord. I can't run and find another interpreter at this late date. We've got these meetings that have got to be had. So, Lord, help me speak Spanish. Just endue me with Spanish. Lord, I'm just not going to speak another word in English till you teach me to do Spanish. For 3 days, he was silent as you could get. Fourth day, he began to preach in Spanish. He began to write in Spanish. And now the government up in, where he lives, calls him and they have arrests made in Spanish because they want to translate it correctly. And I thought, dear Lord, we don't really believe those things happen today. But they do. And they do in the pleasure of God. And when they spoke in other tongues coming out of that upper room, they saw it the first time and he saw it again. Oh, oh, oh. I tell you, brother, I don't know if I can get through these scriptures or not, but 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 3, therefore I exhort you first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, for all who are in authority, that you, Timothy, may lead a quiet and peaceful life in godliness and reverence. Then he began to give some rapid-fire things to Pastor Timothy. You be a good man whose life can't be spoken against. You know that being a pastor is a good calling, a great ambition. You know you got to be the husband of one wife. You must be hardworking and thoughtful and orderly and full of good deeds. You must be a guy that enjoys having guests in his home and must be a good Bible teacher. You're not to be a drinker or quarrelsome, but you're to be gentle and kind, not to be one who loves money. You have to be well-behaved family. And you must never lay hands on a new Christian to be a pastor. Oh, wait. He comes to 1 Timothy 4:17, I mean 7, with a real verse. Don't waste time arguing over foolish ideas, silly myths, and legends. Spend your time and energy in the exercise of keeping spiritually fit. Exercise yourself spiritually and practice being a better Christian. Now, he's telling that to a guy ordained, commissioned by the congregation. The early church knows him well. He has a heritage of Lois and his grandmother. He's got all kinds of background. He's a man who has memorized much of the Torah and understands the epistles that have been sent to him. And he's saying, teach these things and make sure everyone learns them. That's the first thing that Paul emphasizes in 1 Timothy 4. Don't let anyone think little of you because you're young. Be their ideal. Let them follow the way you teach and live, and be a pattern for them in your love, in your faith, and your clean thoughts. I'm going to tell something on this broadcast that you may not want me told, so you can edit it out if you want to. But when that group got together in the Holy Ghost and called you to Australia to those three churches, and you went under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and revival broke out and is still going on, that's the kind of ministry that God wanted to have in Timothy. And that's why he sent Paul to write Timothy 1st and 2nd. Meditate on these things. Give attention to exhortation. Read and explain the scriptures to the church. Preach God's word. Do not neglect the gifts that are in you, which were given to you by prophecy, with the laying on of hands of the eldership. They had prophetic words that came out of their mouth toward you. They are true words. Preach by them. When you go to getting faltery on your inside, when you go to getting thoughts that say, well, I'm not worthy to do this, or I'm not possible, remember the impossible God. Relations are sure. Remember that he's got a harvest for those that are his. Remember that you must depart from iniquity. Meditate on these things, he says, 1 Timothy 5. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident. Take heed to yourself and to your doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear. Oh, wait a minute. What did I just hear in that scripture? You will save yourself and those who hear you. Does that mean that his salvation might have been in question? I don't think so. But I do believe he will save himself from much difficulty and many trials, and those who are with him will do the same. Then he said some practical things you need to know. Don't rebuke an older guy. Us 80-year-olds just don't like rebuke, especially from a 30-year-old. But we'll take it every once in a while, because we know it's needed and true. Exhort him like a father. Oh, bless the Lord. Somebody called me from Chicago the other day and said, you know, fathers are hard to come by in the ministry. I looked at you as a father of the faith, and I wept, because that's the last thing I would have thought of myself. But I tell you what, when he told Timothy to look upon him as a father, and young men as brothers, and older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with all purity, when he said to him, don't receive an accusation against an elder except by two or three witnesses, that gave a poignancy to his life. He didn't hear all the gossip that he sometimes have to. Honor widows who are truly widows. I love that passage. And refuse the younger widows who haven't learned yet to give themselves over to God. I say that might have something to do with single mothers in the congregation. It's a good thing, old man, to flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness, and fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you, in the sight of God, who gives life to all things, I urge you before Christ, who has witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless, until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing, which he will manifest in his own time, for he is blessed and the only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I read that, I thought, dear Lord, if we challenged young pastors with this kind of authority, what would we be doing? But that's not all. I don't know, our time is running out by a long shot. But I want to get in before I withdraw into my cocoon.
You are just fine. Keep cruising, brother.
Well, it's the Word of God, and we're looking at it separated from other things that are in those passages. It's easy to read 1st and 2nd Timothy and to look at passages in there that are admirable and, you know, that build you up and all of that, and they should, but they're taken out of context because I have failed to find many pastors who have preached this book in entirety, and I think it's a mockery to say the Lord will deliver us out of them all and not realize what iniquities and things it's talking about. Teach and exhort these things that I give to you. What are the things? And he says, the things that are practical. I charge you before God and Christ and the elect angels that you observe the things I've told you without prejudice, doing nothing with partiality. Don't lay hands on anyone hastily, nor share in other people's sin. Keep yourself pure. Now, whatever it takes, do it. If it means running out of the church on Sunday morning saying, Lord, deliver me from this mob of unbelievers, it could be that.
I just have to say this at this point. There have been times, Dr. Oliver, where I've gone to churches full of the joy of the Lord and left miserable.
Yes.
And had to pray the church off of me so I could enter back into my abiding state of relationship with God, because there is a presence over that group that is not the Spirit of the Lord, although the building clearly says church. And what people don't understand oftentimes is that the physical and the spiritual are not always in complete agreement. And just because the building says church on it doesn't mean that the devil doesn't have a foothold and a spirit he's appointed in that place that the leadership has agreed to be in covenant with. And when you go into that house, it's a different spirit. And I'm amazed that, like, when I've been in that situation, well, I'm not just there alone. There's not 10 people. Hundreds of people will be there, sitting under that week after week.
Well, the message of Paul to Timothy is that you're going to have to withdraw yourself from some things. You're going to, in 1 Timothy 6:5, from such people withdraw yourself. Anyone who teaches otherwise than the gospel I've taught to you and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, from such withdraw yourself. So you were right to leave the congregation. You were right to withdraw yourself. And I tell you, let me say this to you. Shortly after 9/11, when a visiting preacher introduced the head of the Muslim League of Houston to the pulpit, my wife and I were the only ones in that congregation. There was a lot of people there who stood up and rose and walked out. It's blasphemy for a Muslim who does not believe in Jesus Christ to occupy the pulpit anointed before God. And no one resisted. No one said anything. And yes, I know that some people would have criticized it. Many people in that congregation did criticize me for walking out. But it was the last time I was there, you see. Because it's the last time you can fellowship with the people who abide in sin. And I saw in an open vision that church burned. And I wept all the way through to my car in the parking lot. And I said, Lord God, what judgment? He said, you wait. Now, I'm going to tell you, folks, there's some judgment in the. I remember being in a church, an Assembly of God church in Northeast Texas. They were mistreating their pastor. They were out of order. They were doing everything. Gossip was flying everywhere, and none of it was right, because I knew the man very well, and I knew that it was untrue. It was so heavy upon him that he had almost a nervous breakdown and went into the hospital. And his wife called me and said, would you preach? And I said, I will. And I delivered a message. But before I delivered a message, the Holy Ghost came upon me prophetically, and I said, unless this church repents of the way you've treated your pastor, it will become a parking lot. It was a formidable brick building in the downtown of that area. It was the oldest of the Assemblies of God in that district. Sure enough, a hospital, which was across the highway, offered them to buy their building. They could go and build a huge building for what they were offering to pay for that old building. They sold it. The medical center demolished it and made a parking lot. My, my, prophecy stands. Oh, that we would understand how serious God is with handling his things. Oh, he tells him to go on. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. Make a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Guard what is committed your trust. Avoid the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what's foolishly called and falsely called knowledge. Stir up the... You know, we know... I've been in pulpits lately. I've seen in pulpits lately that are enamored with the Greek and Hebrew. In the Greek it says this, it really doesn't mean what you think it says in the Scripture, so all of your thoughts are unknown and should be changed to what I'm twisting. I've seen them do that. I could care less what that ingredient has. To me, it's contradictions and false knowledge. But stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of hands. For God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind, and young Timothy can overcome anything with that triumvirate. The first thing he attacked was fear. The next thing he said, you got the power and the love, and you got a good mind, use it. Boy, would that be a good charge at a laying on of hands for a new pastor. Hold fast the pattern of sound words which you've heard from me, he said. For Paul said, in faith and love, they are come from Jesus Christ, and the good thing which is committed to you, keep by the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. Now, wait a minute. I'm going to back up here. The Holy Ghost doesn't abide in some pastors, and the Holy Ghost doesn't abide in some congregational members. Just because you walked down and said, yeah, I do to the church, doesn't mean you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost in fire. I wrote a book entitled Consumed by His Fire. It's the point of fellowship. I can't have fellowship with you, Dan, without the flame of God being intervening. I see it in your eyes. I see it in your face. I know it in your heart. I know things about you that you don't even have to tell me about, because in the Holy Ghost, I know things that are mysteries to others. Oh, I tell you what, there needs to become a fear in the 2016 church. Fear of us who know the Holy Ghost, because we can tell you who you've been messing with and what day you were doing it and where you were and what their name is and what the telephone number is and what you've got to do to repent. They need to fear that. Because the church that sees Ananias and Sapphira die in their presence and be carried out needs to have a different kind of church meeting than what some are having. That's just extra. I threw that in. A wonderful thing that was in this passage, though, that I don't want to miss. Remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruination of the hearer. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a workman that does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Flee those youthful lusts. Avoid foolish and ignorant disputes. Become a servant of the Lord who doesn't quarrel but was gentle and kind, able to teach, patient. Walk in humility, but correct those who are in opposition. I'm telling you, that's a strong word there. Know this. Now, when Paul tells you to know something, I think that's important. You might build a seminar somewhere, teach pastors training based on this. Know this. Oh, I like that. Know this. In the last days, perilous times will come. Well, you and I are living in the last days. There'll be those who are lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, all those people who are out of self-control. Lovers of pleasure more than the lovers of God, having a form of godliness, sound like religion, and denying the power thereof. Because you see, Paul was telling young Timothy, keep yourself by the Holy Ghost that dwells within you. When we lay hands on you and you receive the Holy Ghost of fire and power, you got an element operating in your life that will guide you into all truth and will keep you from making the mistakes that people make without him. And when people think they can walk without the Holy Ghost, they need to have a change in their mind. And the churches that have failed to deliver a call for baptism in the Holy Ghost sin against God and against their congregation. It's not an option. But you're going to suffer, Timothy. That's an inevitable. In 2 Timothy 3:10 and down to 3:12, all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you've learned them, me. Praise the Lord. And that from a child you have known the Holy Scriptures. As a child you were brought up knowing what was right and what was wrong. And you know that those Scriptures can make you wise for salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. You know that. And you know that I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching, that you may be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist and fulfill your ministry. All the evangelist is always gathering, always calling for repentance, calling for the altar, calling that there be a change in your life. A dear friend of mine, whom we're going to honor in this next month's newsletter, January 1st newsletter, Lauren Davis, passed away. For him to have 100,000 people at one campaign in Africa, it was not unusual. 300,000, not unusual. And why the Lord took him before we were ready for him to, I don't know. But I know this, he did the work of an evangelist. It meant sometimes living in a hut among the native people themselves in the Serengeti. We helped him build a couple of churches, but I want you to know that where those churches landed, the Holy Ghost was there too. Now I'm going to just read something and we're going to wind up with this. Undoubtedly, Paul was convinced that all that was said was needed for Timothy to know. So I say both 1 and 2 Timothy need to be reviewed. He delivered his message and gave the best that he had. in this blockbuster epistle. Truth and demand ooze from its pages, and the very heart of the great missionary is unveiled for view. If what he preached in the early days of the church was needed then, ask yourself, how much more is it needed now? But it is a sin to quote from Timothy and exclude the preaching of this book. It's a mockery not to deliver the message to the church, to grieve the Holy Ghost. Why attend a fellowship that is not approved by God's presence? Better there be empty seats than empty hearts. Better there be a blessed few than a lost multitude. Better to have empty offering plates than stuffed prelates pretending to preach righteousness and true holiness. Let there be a cleansing in the clergy, and out of their tears of repentance let holiness be birthed, showing a genuine love for the people. O Lord, let Sunday gatherings be filled with testimonies of what is flowing throughout the anointed crowd. O Lord, let them drink from the water of life instead of the Kool-Aid. Pastor, let them say of you, he preaches like one of those old-time gospel preachers, instead of he was a grump, bump, and grind entertainer with great charisma. For charisma may be great to benefit an actor or a public speaker, but it does not compare to the robes of a priest before an altar of flame, yielding a different sight than what modern churchmen have ever seen. I can say a little more because that's my heart. It was Paul's. It was Timothy, and it will do when I leave the earth, as it does for me now, brother. I do love you, Brother Dan. Thank you for giving me a chance to say something.
Thank you for saying it. If there's one last thing that I can get you to say about 2016, in light of all the Lord's put on your heart, what is that?
It'll be a great separation like a plumb line. And we're already seeing it begin, but the foundations of our economy will be shaken tremendously. I know that. And I know the political scene will be the same. But it does not matter to the true believer. Who is to fear not? That's the first word you hear when Moses was telling Joshua, you're getting ready to go into the promised land now. You're going to lead these people. Fear not. The first words that Jesus said to his disciples was, fear not. He speaks the word against fear, and fear is a great thing to overcome right now because there are threats on every side. And I'm not going to join the pathetic prophetic and try to spell out a bunch of things that I don't know, but I do know this, that solid word is nevertheless the foundations of God are immovable, impregnable, full of power, full of the ability to preserve. And if you stand on that foundation, you will stand in the very end. Also, the Lord knows those that are His. Thank God for that. We have to own Him, and He has to own us. It's a dual relationship. And in that Song of Solomon writing, the Solomon's Secret, I believe I pointed that out in a poignant way, that the writer of that wonderful, wonderful book, parallel to the New Testament, cries out with those in the New Testament, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come, come, Lord Jesus, quickly. Oh, it's a great day we're living in. I remember the plumb line, though, very much. I was standing in a church in Bentonville, Arkansas, and the Lord said, put a plumb line on that Lucite pulpit and tell them the division is being made today. Are you with me or are you not? Oh, I love it. It's get downtown, Dan. It's just get downtown.
I agree. It is get down time. You know, Dr. Oliver, it is such a joy to have you on the program. I could just listen to you talk all day. I'm like,
Oh man.
You done? Oh, man. Let me ask some more questions.
I hear you.
But this is the thing. See, God has connected us to Him, His realm, and His kingdom.
Yes.
And He designed us to be a company of people that would tap into. As a matter of fact, in the book of Philippians, it says, "For we are citizens in heaven, from which we await the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." I just, for the life of me, cannot understand why Christians are so based and earthbound in their thinking. And it's get down time, but you don't get down with earthbound thinking. You get down with a revelation that you are called to be fully sold out to God, such that the realm and person of Jesus Christ is interfacing with you and coming through you to this world, such that the apostle said, "It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." That interface ministry, well, that's when fear begins to run from you under any circumstance.
Amen to that.
And Dr. Oliver, there's a lot of things coming on the earth, but I believe that heaven is on the edge of their seats, the great cloud of witnesses, in anticipation of the things that God is going to pour out in these days through those that stand on Him and His word. I don't think going out. Oh, come on. Now I'm going to start preaching. No.
Even in Timothy rises up in my spirit, for there's a passage in which Paul says to Timothy, when I was being accused of all these things, no one stood with me. And Lord, don't lay that to their account, but the Lord stood with me and delivered me from it all. And he was telling Timothy, there may come a time when nobody, and I thought about, nobody stood with Paul. I mean, in the hour he needed them most, when he could have used somebody at least hold him up a little bit, no one was there. He had to go that alone. Do you mean the great preacher that went across continents and began many churches and the missionary movements? You mean that man, there wasn't one that stood with him? That's what he said. When I was accused, no man stood with me. Only the Lord stood with me and delivered me from it all. Oh, I could preach on that for an hour. I've seen that happen in my own life. I've seen angels stand beside me and dare the guy pointing a gun at me to do anything. I want you to know, folks, this is a real thing that we're talking about. It is, you know, it's not play. We're in this. We stepped into the waters, and it has gone from our ankles to our neck, and we're over our head in it. We're swimming in that river that comes out from the throne of God. And it's not going. We're not able to touch bottom and have the security of knowing that we're not floating. We're just feeling the power that God has come forth with His love and His mercy, His tenderness, His joy, His revelation. Those things are what we live in. Oh, my favorite song is "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need of, His hand has provided. Great is His faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Yeah.
This is why I love doing programs with you, Dr. Oliver. I mean, it's just fantastic. Folks, our guest has been Dr. C.R. Oliver. His website is www.zadokpublications.com. That's ZADOK publications.com. I just want to thank you again. for blessing us today with your profound insight and ministry. I know for a fact that you'll be back again. So, folks, until next time, God bless and Godspeed.
Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall is the premier radio program designed to center you on the kingdom of God, to equip you with faith in Jesus Christ, and to unveil the truth behind the lies. This program has been a production of Bride Ministries. You can find us at www.bridemovement.com. At our website, you can contact us, access resources, and support us with donations. We need partners in order to continue to produce our vision, which is to promote unity in the body of Christ worldwide and assist in the creation and development of sheep nations. Partner with us and be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Until next time, God bless and Godspeed.